nyama tamu sadabwe ine kwatungo kunwa nyama tamu sadabwe ine kwatungo kunwa jikwimba gitara ya jolilanga tichitsu jikwimba gitara ya jolilanga tichitsu
Committee of Sindikidwa Dream Program is an international organization working in 10 African countries, including Malawi, whose objective is to increase access to HIV treatment services for people living with HIV and AIDS. In 2015, I was selected to be one of the AVAC fellows, and I was supposed to implement a project whose goal was to increase access to HIV prevention interventions for young women and girls in Malawi. The reason why I chose young women and girls is because, just like in many African countries, in Malawi, young women and girls are the worst affected, I should say, when it comes to HIV and AIDS. So there were a number of activities which I was supposed to implement with regards to that project. And the first one was to create awareness of the Aspire trial, which was being conducted in 4 African countries. The Aspire trial was a phase 3 efficacy trial, which was looking at the efficacy as well as the safety of dabigatran in preventing HIV amongst healthy, sexually active, HIV-negative women. I was supposed to create awareness among different stakeholders, and these were the civil society organizations, the media, the policymakers, as well as the intended beneficiaries. And I was also focusing on some of the key populations like the sex workers. In terms of Aspire, there were a number of activities that were conducted. I conducted different meetings with civil society organizations.
I would like to welcome you to this meeting. We'll try to keep it as brief as we can. We know people are busy, and we do appreciate for taking some time to be with us. Whenever they want to conduct like a study, they are supposed to follow what they are called good participatory practices. So there are steps that they're supposed to, you know, to take, and one of them is to make sure that, you know, they conduct stakeholder meetings or brief, you know, make sure that everyone in the country, be it policymakers, the intended beneficiaries, the civil society organization, are aware. And not just end there, but also be able to update them now and then. We say, okay, for example, in the beginning, we told you that we want to start, you know, conducting this study. And maybe midway, they should also be able like, to call the same the people together and be able to update where they are with the trials. So, but I think what I've noticed is that most of them, I don't want to speak on behalf of them, but it doesn't happen. Most of the time, it doesn't happen that way. That's why we end up in situations whereby people are not aware that there's a certain study. Or some of us, maybe we have gone to international meetings and you find that Malawi is participating in a trial, which you never heard of when you were in your country. It's always strange when it happens like that. So maybe considering the fact that UNC and JHU are going to be in this meeting, so it will also be an advantage, you know, for us to raise this concern.
We have a lot of policies that are lying, that are gathering dust in the shelves. But then when it comes to translating that into implementation, it becomes a challenge. So then what's our role to ensure that all these policies are implemented?
The media and the policy makers, just to create this awareness amongst the stakeholders.
We have to inform the authorities, which is the National Health Sciences Research Committee, that the participant is so-and-so, is, you know, the media group is asking for several participants to, you know, to be part of their meeting or for them to interview, you know, things of that nature. So it borders around confidentiality and consent. So unless we go around that, then that would easily be done. But as things stand now, it's not a straightforward thing that we can go to participant X and say, attend this meeting. Unless one, we have their consent, and then we inform the authorities. Mm-hmm.
I also conducted a number of radio programs in coordination with the John AIDS and UNC project.
Today we are looking at the importance of scaling up our funding. Funding poses a very big challenge in terms of research towards Mancobi sites.
Chintu ina so chime ndi machiona kuti chimene chikusoweka ndi chidwi, kuigira po chidwi pa kafukufuku. Chifa nthawi zambiri nimapezeka kuti tikapita mwina maiko anzathu mukamapita mmameeting mumamva kuna kuti panachitika research yakuti yakuti inachitika ku Malawi. Yetu ku Malawi kunoko mwina anthu sakudziwa kuti panachitika research imeneyo ndipo inaonetsa zotsatira zabwino ndipeka mwachitsanzo panachitika research yokhuza ndi zama cash transfers kuzomba yosonyeza kunawo kuti muka apatsa achinyamata ma cash transfers amathandizira kunawo kuti athe kuchepetsa muyezo umene angatengere kachilombo ka HIV ndipo chifukwa cha research imene chinapeza kuti anzathu maiko ena anapanga benefit kuchokera ku research imene ndipo anamba kupanga scale out
chizambiri zabwera chifukwa cha chani cha kafufu makondomu achikuti abwere zosizicha sizina kubwera zimachokera kafufu ndizofunika anthu munazindikire fuka anthu akazindikira ndekuti kafufu kosapita pasogolo ndekuti so tithe kulimba naso ndi mliri umene mugwira.
Apart from that, I also targeted the ward councillors just to make sure that since you know the ward councillors are the authorities that are usually closer to the people. So I had to make sure that you know they are aware of this trial which was happening so that when the results are out they should be in a better position even to advocate, you know, for whether rollout or access or whatever it is of the final product of the trial. Each and every day we still have a lot of new infections that are happening. For example, just on average in 2014, we had 34,000 new HIV infections, meaning 34,000 people got infected just in 1 year alone. So you can imagine the number is still big, which means we still have a lot of work to do to make sure that people, you know, are prevented from HIV, to make sure that people are not getting infected. So that's why we are bringing in more new HIV prevention interventions so that people have got choices. So how does it work? So maybe I may not be able to explain clearly how it works, but then I've got a 5-minute video which I want you to watch.
PrEP means pre-exposure prophylaxis, and it's the use of medication to help keep someone who does not have HIV from getting infected with it. This is important because HIV continues to be a worldwide health crisis. In the U.S. alone, there's an estimated 1.2 million people living with HIV. And many of them do not know they're infected. About 50,000 people become infected with HIV in the U.S. every year. There are lots of ways to stay safe from HIV, and using condoms has been the main strategy for years. PrEP, though, is a new HIV prevention strategy that's recently been approved by the U.S.
We advocate to say it's better not to take alcohol when you're taking these drugs. That's when they are at their best. But as of now, if you look at the type of people that this drug is trying to target, it's truck drivers, sex workers, these are mostly people that consume alcohol. So I'm sure if someone who is taking alcohol and he wants to have a spare will or have an extramarital sex, would want to take the medication. As long as they take that medication, studies have shown that it will work, but the only danger is them not forgetting taking the medication. But if they take it, so much the good, they will be protected.
Apart from the Aspire, I was also involved in the COP process, the PEPFAR COP process, in terms of developing the COP, advocating, making sure that you know HIV prevention is part of the agenda. So as I've already said, my project was looking at HIV prevention. So whenever I was involving myself, I was participating in the core process, I was making sure that HIV prevention, especially for young women, was part of the core. So I had to make sure that HIV prevention interventions are part of the core process and that they are included. Apart from the core process, I was also actively involved in the DREAMS initiative, which aimed at reducing the number of new HIV infections amongst adolescents. As an advocate and as someone implementing a project around increasing access to HIV prevention options for young women, I had to make sure that I was making the voices of the young women heard in the whole process of developing the DREAMS, the program itself, and whatever was associated with the program.
Nowadays, there's a lot of resistance from the youth. So if we bring in PEP and then we bring in Aspera, whatever it is, how can we, how should I put it? Maybe if we talk about how can we get over the resistance from the youth or from young women or anybody else. I feel like resistance is actually a big issue in Malawi right now, especially when it comes to youth. Yes.
You have an issue with resistance.
Yes. Yes.
For all these HIV, new HIV.
Yes, technologies and everything.
Apart from that, I was also involved in the Global Fund process. As in 2015, it was a Global Fund year where Malawi was involved in the development of the Global Fund concept note. So I had to make sure that, you know, I participate in the whole process, making sure that HIV prevention still remained on top of the agenda of whatever priorities would go into the Global Fund concept note. So in the overall, that's what I've been doing as an AVAC advocacy fellow for 2015. So far, the year has been amazing. I've learned a lot of things as an advocate before I became a fellow. I never knew anything about advocacy. I didn't know that, you know, I could be able, you know, to participate in meetings or be able maybe to stand up to donors or to policymakers to say, look, this is what we want or this is what the people want on the ground. But through this project, I've learned a lot of advocacy skills, which I'm hoping that I'm going to take forward as I continue in this journey of advocacy. And I should say that I think I love advocacy. I think it's, you know, it's the most amazing career one would want to take. I would like to encourage you that, you know, the AVAC fellowship is not just an ordinary fellowship, but just know that it also depends on how you take it. If you take it seriously, you're going to learn a lot from it. But if you don't take it seriously, you're going to move out of it without benefit anything. So my message and my advice to you is take it seriously. Implement whatever you'll be implementing with passion. Passion pays. You know, all throughout my fellowship, the advocacy fellowship, there's one thing that has been driving my energy, you know, towards whatever I was doing, and that was passion. I had passion for whatever I was doing. So I would also urge you, I would also encourage you that, you know, in whatever you're going to be doing, make sure that you're doing it with passion. It's by the end of the day, it's not just about you being, an alumni or of the AVAC fellowship, or, you know, it's not just about participating in all those meetings, but by the end of the day, it's also about making a change in the communities that we're coming from. Remember, if you call yourself an advocate, you know, most of the times you're not speaking on your own behalf, but it means you're speaking on behalf of somebody else. So if you're coming into this fellowship calling yourself advocates, make sure that, you know, the voices of the people that are on the ground are actually being heard, and that when you finish this fellowship, you should be able to, you know, to pat yourself on the back to say, as an AVAC fellow, I managed at least, you know, to speak on behalf of these people, and I managed to bring change, you know, in the communities that you're coming from. Thank you.
Imagine a world where women have control over their sexual health. A world where women are able to say no to unsafe sex. Every day, women are getting infected with HIV simply because they cannot negotiate for safe sex. A decision on whether a condom should be used during sexual intercourse is usually made by the male partner. This puts women at risk, especially if the male partner is HIV positive. I would love to see a world where women have total control over their sexual health.
sabat